Peter speaks of a living hope that we have through faith when he writes these words. Blessed be the God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Living hope. This living hope to which Peter speaks that comes through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead is what lies at the heart of who Jim Davis was and is. Is. Present tense. Intentionally is. Because of Jim's faith in Christ, his hope now is fully realized. It is no longer hope, but is fact, truth, that he knows as he humbly stands in the glorious presence of his King, his Savior, his God. This hope fully realized. Jim, but this hope is for us also, and it is what enables us on this day to come to this service in which he is remembered with joy and rejoicing even amidst grief and sorrow. Jim would have it no other way because he loved this hope. He loved the gospel. And through this gospel, the power of God and the salvation, God changed the heart of this one man. And through this one man, the life of many. Sinners saved by grace, God brought glory to himself. And through the love of Jesus, Jim learned to love. Through his words, his service, his ministry, his love for his family, and his love for his church. On behalf of the family of Jim Davis, I thank you for coming today, for your kindness in attending, for your faithfulness in extending words of comfort and love to the family, and for your prayers for them, even as they grieve. Please pray with me. Father, we come ever mindful that you are God, and according to your great mercy, you are a God of great mercy, and through that mercy, you caused us to be born again to a living. So we remember before you this day the life of Jim Davis. We thank you for your goodness in giving him to us, his family, and his friends to know and to love as a companion in life. And we pray, Lord, in your endless mercy, that you would comfort those who mourn, that you would give us faith, Lord, and hope to see in death the gateway to eternal life. Help us to see that your love, unending, unbreaking, unyielding love, never fails. And that you turn the shadow of death into daybreak because you conquered death through the resurrection. It is in the victorious name of Christ Jesus that we pray. Amen. Let me invite you to stand, please, as we sing together hymn 401 to your worship folder, When Peace Like a River Tends to Run Away.
Thank you.
years at Alloway Gardens in Georgia. And so from the time he was a very little boy, he learned these hymns. And he learned them, and he learned to love them. And even still, would love to join in song whenever given the opportunity, as he would celebrate God's true word. We've asked Hannah Davis to come forward for a scripture reading.
Philippians 4:4-7. Rejoice in the Lord. I say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus.
James Alvin Davis was born in the small town of LaGrange, Georgia, on June 21st, 1942, to hardworking, industrious parents. That same day, General Rommel led the German offensive in North Africa, capturing the town of Tobruk. It was an uneasy time, even in rural Georgia. But for the Davises, it was a joyous day as they were celebrating the birth of their firstborn, a son. From an early age, Jim witnessed what hard work and dedication looked like. As his father worked as a successful businessman in many ventures, and his mother as a loving wife and gifted musician. When Jim was in second grade, God blessed the Davises with a baby girl, Joy. And together they were raised as a family, raised in a home where they came to hear of Jesus, the love of Jesus, and the good news of the gospel. Jim was a loving and caring brother, even from a young age, for the most part, except for that one time when he tied his little sister to a pole, much to his father's dismay. As a young man, Jim took an interest in ham radio, playing the trumpet, Boy Scouts, where he eventually attained the rank of Eagle Scout. In high school, he was recognized for both his Christian character and his academic achievement. College years were spent at Georgia Technical Institute, where Jim could pursue his interests in electronics and engineering. He joined ROTC, and after graduating from Georgia Tech, he served in the Navy for 5 years in California, teaching at the Navy's Nuclear Power School in the area of quantum mechanics. While there, Jim met a Londoner by the name of Frieda Giles. She was traveling around the world and happened to be working for several months in San Francisco to save up money for the next stop to Australia, and then eventually returning to England via Asia. Jim quickly realized that this was a special young lady. She was an intelligent, charming, godly follower of Christ who knew her Bible well and was courageous enough to disagree with him in a Bible study. This is all Jim needed. So he began to pursue her, and as luck would have it, Frieda's round-the-world travels came to an end there in Berkeley, California, and after a suitable time of courtship, they returned to England, where they were married. It wasn't but a year or so later that they were blessed with the birth of their first son, Mark. As their young family grew, Jim completed his service in the Navy, and then took a job with Bell Labs in Naperville. Bell Labs made it possible for Jim to pursue a master's degree and a doctorate degree from Stanford University in electrical engineering. Now, unless you knew Jim in a professional context, you might not know that he did his PhD research with Dr. William Shockley, the Nobel laureate and inventor of the transistor. And who had been the founder of what we know today as Silicon Valley. And in fact, it was the first of Jim's 10 patents that he did jointly with Dr. Schopper. I knew Jim for 15 years. I never knew that about him, which speaks of his humility. While at Stanford, Jim and Frieda's second son, Giles, was born at Stanford University Hospital. After completing his doctorate, Jim and family returned to Glen Ellyn to continue working with Bell Labs. In 1976, their third son, Timothy, was born at Central DuPage Hospital. And Tim, as you know, is a young man with boundless energy, good humor, and a wonderful spirit who loves to tease and to joke. Just 1 year after Tim's birth, Jim was diagnosed with cancer, Hodgkin's lymphoma, stage 4, advanced, and he nearly died. A significant time. It was a hard season. And yet, as Jim recovered, because of his faith in Christ, he had a strong sense of peace and joy. The peace of Christ that you heard read just a moment ago. The peace of Christ that surpasses all understanding. And the joy of Christ that your greatest needs are not physical or even material, but are spiritual, and that they have been met by Christ. That's the peace and the joy that Jim knew that ran deep into the depths of his soul and sustained him for many decades to follow. In 1990, Jim left Bell Labs with 30 years of credited service to join TRA as a developer instructor for training in the telecommunications industry. At TRA, Jim's focus has been on developing training for engineers in cellular technology for companies such as Motorola and Cisco. And it continued until his final days of life, always serving and working well. It's easy to see that Jim Davis was an accomplished professional, but in the 15 years of knowing him, I never heard him talk about those accomplishments. When I think of Jim Davis, I think of him in two very significant ways. First, as a family man, and second, as a churchman. Jim loved his family. He was not a perfect husband or a perfect father, but he was a faithful one for almost 5 decades. He loved his sons, and he was proud of them. He loved his daughters by marriage, and thankful for them and his grandchildren, and he was quick to talk about them at every turn. Mark, he was proud of you and your work with Northern Trust, and Sue, with your work with the Christian Health Clinic. He was appreciative of your love and concern for him and for your mom, and he loved Hannah and Sarah and Esther. Giles, he loved you, Debbie, and he was proud of your work as missionaries in Spain and Sin. You know he loved the gospel, and he was passionate about missions and seeing that the spread of the gospel across the globe would take place for the glory of Christ. He was always quick to talk about what God was doing on the other side of the Atlantic. He loved Micah and Nate and Becca and Jacob. He was proud. And he loved you. He loved you greatly. He loved your spirit and your energy. He loved your humor and your tenderness. And he worked hard for you, Tim, as a board member of Stars Family Services, to establish a house where you could live independently and grow and thrive and flourish. And so you are. He loved you as a bigger brother, caring for you and protecting you and looking out for you. And Frieda, you know his love as a faithful husband for almost 50 years. Jim Davis was a family man. He was also a church man. He loved Jesus Christ. He loved the body of Christ. He loved the church. He served this church beautifully and faithfully for more than 2 decades. He was an active part of our STARS Disability Ministry. Ian Frieda helped lead our newcomers for more than 20 years. They were warm and welcoming and gracious. This is where I first met them as a newcomer to Collins Church. He and Frieda were involved with International Student Fellowship. He served across the breadth of this church as a greeter, working and serving with our Helping Hands ministry, but also he helped lead this church, serving on our missions board and then our elder board. Jim Davis was a churchman because of his love for Jesus Christ, the head of the church. Jim knew well the saving grace of God through Christ and his redeeming love and was always mindful of it. In his own words, he captures that truth when he says this. Jim and Frieda are mindful of God's grace in their lives, and their desire is to honor Jesus Christ, their Lord and Savior. A beautiful distillation of a life lived well in the glory of Christ. We've asked a number of family members to come forward and share remembrances of his life in such ways to give glory to the Savior.
My name is Mark Davis. I'm Jim's son, and this is my daughter, Sarah Davis, who is his granddaughter.
So, you're all here today because of my grandpa, but I call him Granddad, and I love him so much, and I still do. And after all, he was an amazing man. I've always wanted to be a mother. For one reason, it always made me and everyone else feel important. If there was something that we liked to do, he would always do it with us. There was a park by their house, and we would go there a lot of times that we visited. And he would always play games with us on the equipment, even though he was in his upper 60s and having medical troubles. Because it was something to do with us, and something, a way to be a part of our lives. And beyond doing what we loved, he always shared with us what he loved. I remember sitting at the breakfast table after we slept over at his house one night, and he had my younger sister read a Br'er Rabbit story because that was his favorite as a kid. And he wanted us to know what he loved and what was important to him because we were important to him. Even with people he didn't know, my granddad would always be very polite and caring to him. I was fortunate enough to be with my grandpa during his last hours, and he couldn't talk, but he could nod and answer questions, or he could make some noises if he tried enough, and he could slightly change the expression in his eyes and the height in his eyebrows. And whenever a nurse would leave after doing something to make him more comfortable, he would always try to mouth a thank you or show his appreciation to them. And when we would say something besides, "Do you want another pillow or are you comfortable?" he would try to make a facial expression that looked like a smile. Even when it was hard for him, his priority was to make everyone else know that they were appreciated. And I'll treasure all of these characteristics, but probably my favorite and the most memorable was his complete trust in God. I found a picture with a quote on it that said, "I do not fear tomorrow because I know God is already there." And I tried to send it to him before one of his surgeries, but I recently found out that it never went through. And I know now that it doesn't really matter because he already knew that. He would fight that every day of his life. When he had to be back in the hospital again, and he knew he had several surgeries or procedures coming up, he would look at it as a chance to improve and his trust for God and his health also. And even on Saturday, when he knew he was going to die, he was at total peace because he knew he had God waiting for him when he woke up. And someday I hope to live as fearlessly and faithfully as my grandpa did.
Read this if I can make it through. remember a man of integrity, love, and compassion. He was a humble man, as has been mentioned already today, not because he did not have accomplishments to be proud of, but because he saw everything from a kingdom perspective. He was humble about his own achievements, but on the opposite, he was fiercely proud of his family. He was eager to tell anyone who would listen about what his children, grandchildren, nieces, nephews were doing. Yeah, regarding his own accomplishments, he was quiet. He was humble. A man who did not see it necessary or beneficial to talk about his own accomplishments. So even though Pastor Augustine has talked about it, I think I wanted to take a few minutes to share some of his accomplishments, because I think it puts things in perspective. My dad graduated number one from his class at Georgia Tech in electrical engineering, recruited by the Navy, assigned to teach nuclear quantum physics at the Naval Nuclear School in San Francisco, hired by Bell Labs, who paid for him to go to Stanford doctoral PhD program. They recognized immediately his talents and asked William Shockley to come out of retirement to teach him and mentor him. William Shockley was a little eccentric at the time, but a brilliant mind, who was the founder of Silicon Valley and invented the transistor. So my dad had the fun. He was always passionate about learning, and he loved to learn from him, and even has some joint patents with him on mobile phones and telecommunications switching circuitry. My dad then had the privilege of representing the United States at the United Nations for several years in Geneva, Switzerland, to discuss globally consistent telecommunications standards and protocols. My dad, as I mentioned, had a passion and thirst for learning. If he had satisfied this thirst with only technical knowledge, I believe he would have missed part of God's purpose for his life and cut short the impact he would have had on others' lives. Instead, my dad sought to apply his thirst for learning, to learning all that he could about his Jesus. In remembrance, I'm much prouder of my dad's close relationship with God than I am with his many earthly accomplishments. I also knew my dad to be the eternal optimist, but not blindly optimistic, but optimistic because he saw each day as an opportunity to obey God's will for his life. Just a week ago, I was driving him to the emergency room, and instead of complaining about going back to the emergency room, he told me that it was nice to get out for the day. My dad lived his life in such a way as to shine Christ's love on everyone he talked with, including the nurses, the doctors, the transport team, the IV teams at Central DuPage Hospital, anybody that he interacted with. And this past Friday, when he checked in the last time, before he was fully checked in, nurses from other floors were coming to see him. They saw him on the admittance list. Nurses and techs were discussing and wanting to be able to provide care for him. They were signing up for the next shift ahead so that they could be part of his care. People were drawn to my dad because of his warm and caring character that God had developed in him over 72 years. But I've learned from my dad that his character did not come by coincidence. It did not come by accident. It was developed by looking for what God had in store for him each day and allowing God to shape his heart through circumstances, both good and bad. My dad provided an incredible example to his three sons and those he helped disciple over the years of how to continually seek God and allow God to shape their own heart. When I think back about what I want to remember most about my dad, it is that I want to continually train my heart as he did to be fully dependent on Christ through all things, regardless of the storms raging around me. My dad provided a beautiful example of this over 39 years that he battled cancer on and off. Sure, he had brief times of anger at his recurring cancer, but he talked his anger through with God. And he came to understand how to depend on God in all circumstances. In the late 70s, when his Hodgkin's cancer had run its course and the doctors had given up hope, God chose to miraculously heal my dad when the elders came and prayed and laid hands on him. It's hard to imagine how our family would have been different if my dad had passed away back then, but I praise God additional years. One of my dad's lingering concerns this year was the possibility that in store for him was a painful death because of bone cancer. So I praise God that he beautifully took him quickly this past Saturday. On Saturday, we had time for family to quickly gather around 6 a.m. to shower our love on my dad, including phone calls from family in Georgia and family in Spain. My dad loved hearing from his family. And then he quickly and painlessly went to be with Jesus. I'm struck by the fact that my dad's vibrant faith now has eyes to see Christ as he is sitting in the very presence of God. What a blessing of a life well lived. What a blessing of a life lived to Jesus Christ. This is the man that I remember as my dad. I love him dearly. I will miss him deeply. I love you, Dad.
My name is Timothy James Harris. I met him for a very long time. As a matter of fact, several weeks. A thousand times. And over and over and over and over, a thousand times in a day. Once a week. All these years, all the days go past. Because Jesus is always there all the time watching us. And I know he is a great Father in heaven. He is. And thank you for all of us for tonight. And thank you for Julie Clements. Thank you for Nathan. And thank you for all of you guys at the church. Nice having you with us. Thank you.
My name is Giles. I'm Jim's second son. I'd like to start out by sharing an excerpt from a testimony my dad wrote of his own life. This is what he wrote. For the first 34 years of my life, life with Christ had been good, and things had planned out much as I expected. With challenges, of course, but under control. My control, I assumed, with God's help. I was in the delivery room when our third son, Tim, was born. And when I first looked at him, I thought he didn't look quite normal. I didn't sleep much that night and prayed a lot. While my prayers were not answered, at least not in the way I had hoped, in the morning, the pediatrician called to inform me that Tim has Down syndrome. That was crushing news. I had never had any dealings with special needs people, and had always pitied their parents. From that moment, bitterness began to grow in my heart towards God. Looking back on it, I believe that a deadly cancer began to grow in me. I now think of it as a cancer of the soul. It was a growing bitterness against life and against God, whose goodness and even his existence I began to question. I don't know how long this cancer of the soul would have continued to grow, or how it might have ruined my life, but I believe that God used a second cancer to cure me of the first. About a week after Tim's birth, after a game of handball, I developed a sore arm, which I attributed to handball, of course. But a week after Tim's birth, when the soreness had not gone away, I decided to see a doctor. He felt around and said that I had a swollen lymph node under my arm and recommended a biopsy. And to my surprise, since I seemed to be in perfect health, the biopsy revealed that I had Hodgkin's lymphoma, and I was checked into Central DuPage Hospital the next day for removal of my spleen and further biopsies of my chest and abdomen. That night in the hospital, after my wife had gone home, I finally caved in. I have been, as it were, shaking my fist in God's face. But at this point, I didn't have the strength to keep doing that, so I prayed a very simple and frank prayer. I said, Lord, I'm not sure if you're even there, and if you are, whether you have anything good for me, but if you'll help me, I'll thank you for it. That was it. Nothing happened. I don't think I expected anything to happen, but somehow I managed to go to sleep that night. The next morning, I awoke to the biggest miracle of my entire life. I was filled with incredible peace. He doesn't share it here, but amazingly so, that very same night, the exact same thing happened in life to my mother. She prayed that same prayer in the morning, woke up. And I had that peace that made no sense. The same night. God never gave me any assurance that he planned to heal me, but just that somehow, whatever he planned, would be okay. At that time, Paul's words in 2 Corinthians 1:8-9 really spoke to me, where he said, we should like you, our brothers, to know something of what we went through in Asia. At that time, we were completely overwhelmed. The burden was more than we could bear. In fact, we told ourselves that this was the end. Yet we believed we had this experience of coming to the end of our tether, that we might learn to trust, not in ourselves, but in God, who can raise the dead. From the depth of a pit and at the end of my tether, a simple cry for help brought God's help in ways that astounded me. It wasn't quick or always easy, but it was predominantly joyful. As over the next 7 years, God provided for us in ways that were just wonderful. What I learned from that experience is that if you're really at the end of your tether, you're in the best possible position to really grab hold of God's resources in Christ if you'll just let him. I was 5 years old when all that happened, and I had no clue what was going on. Absolutely not. I noticed, of course, when my dad lost his hair, but I had no idea what chemotherapy was. I had no idea he was on the brink of death. God miraculously healed him of that cancer and gave him many more years to live out his testimony of God's grace and joy for his faithfulness. And my dad discovered, as we all do, that when we follow God through hard times, God can actually use those hardships to bless us. Have we not lived that? His initial bitterness came from the birth of a Down syndrome child, but later he would discover the great gift of joy and laughter that Tim would bring to all of our lives. Only God could know that my dad needed someone in his life who would dance around like a monkey and say, can you do that, Dad? I think Jim needed that. He needed it. As an adult, I look back on this time of my life, my dad's life, and I thank God for it. As a five-year-old, I had no idea the refining work my Heavenly Father was doing in my earthly father. God was focusing in on him, like my dad said in his testimony, focusing in on that cancer, but not the cancer physically, but that cancer of the soul, which is what concerned God a whole lot more. He destroyed that cancer within my father. And in so doing, shaped him into a man who truly trusted God with the control of his life. And as always the case, this transformational healing within Dad didn't just affect him, but all of those of us around him. Me, for example, Mark, Tim, all of us, we grew up with a firm understanding that God was in control and that we were meant to follow him wherever he led. And we didn't necessarily even gain this understanding from lectures or sermons that my dad taught. We picked it up the way one picks up a scent that lingers in a room. I remember how I learned to do daily devotions. It wasn't because my dad taught me that I have to do them. It's because I would come down in the morning. And I would see him sitting there reading his subtly, very subconsciously, I understood. This is what a man does. This is what a man of God is. Dad struggled with various other forms of cancer throughout his life. God didn't give it to him easy, but he had learned his lesson well the first time. He was always positive and thankful to God for whatever he could thank him for in the darkest of times. When he was diagnosed with cancer in the bladder, he had to have his bladder removed. He stood up with that bag that was connected on the outside of his body. Instead of complaining, he thanked God for now he can get a full night's sleep without having to get up to pee. He actually said, I highly recommend it. You can drink all he wants and then just hook up the big bag and go to bed. The good news is, that was the phrase that Dad would always say. Well, the good news is, I'm not doing anything. The good news is, it's nice to get out. The good news is, this wasn't just a Joel Osteen positive thinking model or way of being. This was because he knew that he was in God's hand. And this is what God's good hand does to someone who opens himself up to be refined by God. Suffering just can't touch that person in the same way anymore. Last fall, I felt like God was challenging me to pray bigger, to ask him for miracles. I realized that I had begun asking God for small things because I was tired of being disappointed when he didn't give me what I asked for. So I sat down on a bench in the park one day and pulled out my little notebook and I started to write out a list of miracles I wanted to ask for. And of course, the very first one I wrote was, God, please heal my dad completely. But no sooner had I written it than I heard God speaking to me very clearly, saying, "But Giles, why are you asking for this when you know it is not my will?" I healed him before so he could make it to this day. But now it is my desire for him to live out the testimony of how a man of God dies. I went from the park that day, mourning my father's death months before it came. That's exactly what my dad did. Even in his final weeks and days, the man would always show me how to live. Has now taught me how a man of God dies. He faced death with the same confidence that God had given him that night in the hospital 39 years ago. The confidence that God is in control. And that in this we find peace and joy. That's our God, isn't it? The face of death gives peace. Yea, though I walk the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. The morning of the day my dad died, I was in Spain, and I received an email from my mom, from Sue, my sister-in-law, saying that Dad was in the hospital again. He'd gone to the hospital various times in the last few months, so it didn't seem too shocking to hear. And yet, as I wrote my prayer to God in my devotions that morning, I felt as if I was writing what I would say at his funeral. Fortunately, I was able to read it to him on the phone hours before he died. I'd like to read it to you just this little bit here today. My dad is in the hospital again. Thank you, Father, Heavenly Father, for the tremendous legacy that my father has left in this world. So many problems I see on a daily basis. Of the failure of fathers. Fathers are not being who they should be. They need to provide for their family. They need to provide love. They need to love God, love their wives, love their kids, and provide discipline and direction. They provide stability and security to their kids. I grew up knowing my dad loved God, my mom, and me. Never was there any doubt. Never did I worry that he might waver in that. He was a rock upon which I could stand to see the world. It is because of him that I have the marriage I have today. I am his legacy. children continue. I have been a youth pastor for over 20 years. In that time, I've seen over and over again the devastating effects of fathers who failed in their role. I see teens, both male and female, desperately seeking love they never found in their fathers. They seek it in all the wrong places, and who can blame them? Because it wasn't available to them where it should have been. I don't mean to diminish the role of mothers in any way, far from it. I simply mean to say that God also designed a crucial role for the father. And when that is not fulfilled, the child suffers. Now, my dad was not perfect. I don't want to paint that picture either. Because it's pointless for anyone to seek to follow his example if we try to believe that he was perfect. His example ever can be followed. He was an imperfect man who, with all his faults and shortcomings, managed to do what mattered most. And so, because of that, he succeeded as a father. He loved God. He loved his wife. He loved his family. He loved others. He wasn't exactly the touchy-feely type. But he found many, many ways, within the limits of his imperfections, to make it known to all that his love was for real. You don't have to be the perfect man to make an impact. You just have to learn that a true man depends on God and recognizes his control over our lives. That's what makes you a man of God like my dad. Do this, and then learn how to express that love to others. God's love will fill you and pour out of you into all you touch, especially your own children. That is my father's legacy. My dad was a brilliant man, and yet his legacy that will change the world for all eternity is the love he left in all of us, his grandchildren as well. I love you, Dad. Proud to be called your son. Thank you for helping me become the man I am today. I will live in such a way that both you and my Heavenly Father will continue to be proud of me. Say hello to Jesus for me and give him a big hug. Tell him I'd love to do the same someday. You did well, Dad. I'm sure that Jesus is saying to you right now, or has already said, well done, good and faithful servant. You fought the good fight. You finished the race. You kept the faith. Goodbye, Dad, but not forever. I'll join you someday soon.
I'm Joy. I'm Jim's only sister, only sibling. I wouldn't be alive if it weren't for Jim. When he was 7, he prayed persistently for a little brother or sister, and I came along the following year. In the elementary years, we would walk to band practice together. Jim played the trumpet, and I played the saxophone. We remember my parents saying we argued over who would sit in the big chair, or would we watch American Bandstand or cartoons. But we actually don't remember that. I do remember when he tied me, but he really didn't tie me to a pole. We agreed that we would tie each other up. We would tie our hands and we would see who could get out first. I tied Jim up and he got right out. He tied me up and I couldn't get out. And about that time, I started crying and my dad came home and heard me crying. And it was very bad for Jim. He got a really bad spanking. Jim always gathered diverse and interesting people around him. I still remember the name of this student he brought home one weekend from Georgia Tech. His name was Bashir Sayar. When I was 15, Jim invited me to San Francisco. He was living there and working there, but he took 2 weeks off to just take me everywhere. We went horseback riding in the Berkeley Hills. We went onto the campus of the University of California at Berkeley so I could debate with the protesters. And we drank apple cider at the forum, we went to Fisherman's Wharf, we went to Carmel. Basically, he gave me my own private tour of Northern California. Later, I spent two summers with Jim and Frida in this area. One summer, they let me bring a friend. Mark was just a baby then. Of course, they did everything to make our stay memorable. As life progressed, Jim was always there for me. Through very personal trials, he was always understanding, never judgmental, praying for me, for my children, advising me when he could, showing real care and concern for me and all my family, praying but also serving us in whatever way we needed. Jim was such a powerful influence in each of my five children and now my four grandchildren. Three of them, plus the four grandchildren, were trying to drive here for the funeral from Georgia. One might still be on the interstate in Kentucky. He was there for 12 hours the last I heard with his baby and three-year-old and wife. And the other ones finally got off in Kentucky somewhere else and managed to get to a hotel. So they really wanted to be here because it was very important to them to be here. They couldn't make it. So that was three of my children. I've always been so happy to tell others about my wonderful brother because of the person he was. I have to insert here that while we're thanking God for Jim, I want to point out one of his secrets, and that's having Frida. He's a loving, faithful, godly companion of 48 years. They were a wonderful team. They were an example to all of us. Jim was a brilliant inventor and teacher, as you've heard, but more importantly, as you've heard, the defining factor of his identity was his faith in God. I found some things that Jim had written when he was thinking about his testimony, and I thought it was very interesting when he talked about his high school and college years. This is his words. I struggled with doubt as to whether my relationship with God was based on more than just feeling and childlike faith. As a science and engineering student, I wanted a rational explanation for things. But as I learned more and more, God was always beyond and greater than my ability to explain him. But eventually, my frustration with not being able to understand him transformed increasingly to awe and wonder at how much greater he is than I am. This process was aided by the gradual realization that it wasn't only God that my mind couldn't fathom. If I found it difficult to really understand intuitively the quantum mechanical description of a hydrogen atom, the simplest atomic structure, then how could I expect to really understand more complex matter and much more complex living matter than God himself? Eventually leads me to revel in God's greatness in the same way I'm awed by the intricate design of his creation. Then Jim quoted someone saying, "You can know more than you can understand." I believe Jim would have been a very different person had he not believed in Jesus. He accepted his forgiveness, his new life, and he committed his whole life to him. God's love changed the direction of Jim's life. Through the various trials of his life, he could have become bitter or discouraged. He could have been a proud member of the intelligentsia, not really having time or care for others. But I believe that we see Jesus in my brother, reaching out to each of us, showing love, care, gentleness, and genuine concern. What would Jim say to us now? I think he would say, "Don't miss the real gift of my life. Don't miss the explanation for who I was among you. It was my relationship with Jesus. If you go away thinking, what an exceptional man," Jim wouldn't say this, but I can say this, "you're right." But I think Jim would want each of us to leave thinking that this awesome God who Jim loved and served also desires a relationship with each of us and has his own unique purpose for each of us, just like he did for Jim. I read this back in February, and I wrote it in a book, and I just thought, goodness, it's so true. This is Psalm 146. "I will praise the Lord as long as I live." Yes. "Even with my dying breath. Don't look to men for help, but happy is the person who has God for his helper, whose hope is in the Lord his God." I'm so grateful God gave me Jim's brother, and I'm going to just praise him for the years that he cared for me and loved me. And thank God for his witness to me and for his care.
Eric Channing. I am regretfully not part of the Davis family, but I got to know Jim very well over the last 3 years in my role here as a pastor of College Church. As has been said many times, anyone who knew Jim knew that he loved Jesus. He loved his Savior. That was apparent to me. It was apparent to every single person he came in contact with. As I was talking to people at the visitation last night, I met people from different areas of ministry he's been involved in. The Stars ministry, the elder, another fellow elder, the welcome people, and even at Windsor. And to a person, the same message was said time and time again about Jim Davis. This was a humble man. This was a compassionate man. And he was a loving man. Summing up, he was a godly man. In 1 Peter, we're told that trials test the genuineness of our faith. And Jim, God tested Jim in his providence over and over for 39 years through the trial of cancer. And it refined this man's faith so that it was as gold. And Jim Davis, he shined the light of Christ wherever he went. It's been said that if a man gets bumped, you find out what's really inside, what spills out. When Jim Davis was bumped by cancer and by other things, what spilled out was the fruit of the Holy Spirit. What spilled out was love. Joy and the peace that they talked about. He had this peace that transcended any kind of circumstance he was in. Gentleness, self-control. Up to the day of his death, that was Jim Davis. Christ in him was so apparent. And Jim's love for Christ manifested itself in a love for his word. Even last week, about this time last week, I called Jim. We had a great talk about the things of the Lord, about eternity, about the hope that he was looking forward to in heaven. And he nonchalantly mentioned, you know, yesterday, I didn't get out of my chair. I was so weak. But in typical Jim fashion, he would never complain about that. He said, but the good news is I had plenty of time to read my Bible and worship. When I think about Jim Davis and what I'm going to miss about him, why I loved him so much, as I've thought about that over the last few days, it's because I saw Christ in Jim Davis. I saw my Savior in Christ in Jim Davis. I saw gentleness, and I saw true humility. I saw somebody who put others above himself, and I was privileged. Know that man. And I know that all of us are going to miss talking with him. Whether wife, or son, or sister, or friends, we're going to miss him, but we're going to be able to talk to him one day again. And I know that right now Jim Davis is rejoicing because he sees his Savior face to face, the Savior who he knew so intimately.
Jim would have wanted exactly this ratio, where 98% of the discussion was about his Christian witness and giving glory to God. And if Jim in heaven was able to participate with us at any point during this ceremony, I don't know what visibility he has to what we are doing here right now. What I'm about to say will probably make him uncomfortable because he was so humble, but especially for Mark, Giles, Tim, our children, you should know that Jim was tremendously well-loved and tremendously respected by his co-workers. He had a formidable intellect and was was able to use it for the glory of God, but also for significant professional success. Your program says that Jim was credited with 30 years of service at Bell Labs. That is very carefully worded. And I'm going to tell a story about what Jim would say about those 30 years of service. The way he told the story was, I joined AT&T out of college and worked for a couple of months and immediately went off to the Navy. And after 5 years in the Navy, I came back to AT&T and they had this unusual policy where they would credit you with years of service to your professional record four times in the military. So having worked there a few months, he was then awarded his five-year service pin. He would joke, he'd like. Then worked a couple more months and went off to graduate school at Stanford. He had heard those stories that worked with Shockley, which was very impressive with us engineers. Spent 5 years there, came back to work at Bell Labs, and was awarded his 10-year service pin. And then Jim would cock his head back and tell the story and give you that little wink. If you know Jim, you know that wink. And he'd chuckle a little bit and say, then I put in 15 honest years of service. And AT&T offered a early retirement package where anyone could have 5 years of service added to their service credit for calculation of their pension. So, and with 30 years of service, having only worked 15 years, was a few months. And the way Jim told the story, it was with the affect of Mark Twain telling the story of a Tom Sawyer, a country boy, who found a way to work the system to his advantage. He'd tell it with that affect. And that was funny for two reasons. It was funny because of the way he told the funny story. But if you knew Jim's professional accomplishments in those 15 years, it was funny because of the way he was joking about it as if he had somehow taken advantage of AT&T's policies. When it absolutely was not true. Those 15 years were replete with tremendous technical accomplishments. What has not been mentioned here is that Jim was awarded the very highest honor of engineers at Bell Laboratories. He was named a Bell Labs Fellow. That's a few Nobel Prize winners in physics, a couple of IEEE fellows, and Jim, and several other very accomplished folks at Bell Labs. But he has a plaque in the hallway of Bell Labs, which is now Novotel Lucent, with the other Bell Labs fellows honoring his great contributions. Super accomplishment there. Many of his 10 patents, which have been mentioned, had to do with a particular design of a line unit on an AT&T switch, where he would always say it was a team member. He was recognized as the guy on the team. AT&T sold billions of dollars worth of that product. It was a key contribution. Anna, Sarah, grandchildren, you may not remember a world without the internet. But we remember a world without the internet. And prior to the internet becoming the internet, when companies needed to network their global data centers, they used a network that was called Frame Relay. AT&T's fundamental patent on the technology of Frame Relay has Jim Davis' name with a couple other folks, and Jim would say, yeah, I was a team member. Right? But it's only a little stretch to say that Jim was one of the inventors of the pre-internet internet. And I will tell that story anyway, right? And you should too. And you should know this about your grandfather. I have other stories. I'm not going to see me afterwards if you'd like to hear more Jim Davis stories. There are plenty of them. But as Jim would want it, he would say, to God be the glory. But I would like to say to Jim Davis be the honor for the unique ability that he had to take God's created electrons and arrange them in such a way that the tremendous things were happening in design. So, Godspeed, Jim Davis. Thank you, Rita. Thank you, Giles, Mark, Tim, for sharing this profession. professional life with us. He was beloved and respected. He was my mentor. I continue to joke, when I grow up, I'm going to be like Jim Davis. We had Bible study together when we trained together. He was a mentor in more than just professionally. And I miss him. Frida, he used to regale me with the stories of the two-seat open convertible up and down the coast of California with Frida. He loved you very much. Mark, Charles, Tim, you don't know me very well, but I know a lot of your history. Because he would always talk about you. So, thank you for this opportunity. Please be a comfort.
It was an extended time to remember Jim's life. I think it is obvious to all that it was done in such ways to exalt Christ.
Thank you. Well, we certainly have been encouraged, challenged, blessed, instructed by what's preceded this brief message. And today the scriptures have been proven true. It's better to go to a funeral than to a party, because you see the right perspective, and you see eternity and its values more clearly. Now, would you give your attention to the Word of God as I read it? Remember also your Creator in the days of your youth, before the silver cord is snapped, or the golden bowl is broken, or the pitcher is broken at the fountain, or the wheel broken at the cistern, and the dust returns to the earth as it was, and the Spirit returns to God who gave it. This is the end of the matter. Fear God and keep His commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. We are met not merely to recall the good things of a good man's life, but we're here to worship God, the source of life and hope. It is the promise of God that Jesus is coming back to earth again, and we will revel in a great and glorious reunion. We shall know each other perfectly, without limitations or regrets. We shall not hide ourselves, wrapped in our own insecurities. We shall be done forever with all kinds of falseness and crippling duplicity. Wonderfully, we shall know God and never another separation. So we rejoice in this truth. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord, for their works do follow them. And because our works do follow us after we die on to eternity, I would like to remind you of four great truths that I know from my personal conversations with Jim that he would be in full agreement. First, life is precious. Life is priceless. Every life is precious. Life is not to be treated like trash. The world system thinks and acts vastly differently, and they consider life to be cheap. But life is not worthless. Life is not to be treated with casual indifference. Find this reading the book of Ecclesiastes as well as other portions of God's Word. The writer of Ecclesiastes uses several metaphors to describe life's values in the midst of fragility. In the text just read, the writer directs our attention to the busy activities of a well-appointed home. A golden bowl filled with oil is suspended by a silver cord, and as it is lowered, refilled, and lighted, and lifted up again, it gives light to the whole household. But a silver cord, perhaps unnoticed, frayed, suddenly snaps. And something that was taken for granted, beautiful, but not cared for properly, falls and smashes to the ground and becomes worthless. it adversely affects other things. A golden bowl crashes and shatters. Inattention to life's preciousness is likened to a common pitcher used to carry water and is inadvertently knocked against the wall, the rock walls of the well, and is smashed and broken. So a silver cord is snapped, a golden bowl is crushed, a pitcher is broken. And this is a word picture Solomon gives to us about we should carefully handle things of life that are given to us, because life in itself is of inestimable value. Life is precious, and it cannot be redone. Life cannot be rebuilt. It cannot be relived. One can make corrections for the future, but one cannot undo the past. Not only is life precious, but life is brief. The young person in years sees life as moving slowly, ever so slowly, to attain the things that they are looking forward to in life. And as a child thinks Christmas will never arrive, so youth sometimes thinks old age will never arrive. But old age is speeding by like the blink of an eye. And how many of us have heard, it seems only yesterday, that such and such happened. The Bible says, life is like a mist that is here today and is suddenly gone. Or again, life is like a flower that flourishes in the morning and is gone in the afternoon. Or again, life is like grass in the field, here today and gone tomorrow. So however long our pilgrimage, a decade or almost a century, we can do nothing to slow down the race of time. Life is brief. We never get a chance to do all the things we would like to do. We do not presume to be here tomorrow. Today's breath is a gift of God, and we do not know but what He will call that breath away, even tomorrow. Our days are numbered, but that number is known only to God. Therefore, wisdom dictates that we give heed to this biblical truth. Life is brief. Live it. Not only is life brief, not only is it precious, but life is not to be wasted. Life is wasted if it's lived for itself, and for selfish gain, and for worldly gain. The world's system of values may call a person successful who can keep on building larger barns, or increasing personal wealth, or climbing higher on the social ladder, reveling in every self-made gain. But God says, you fool, such a person, you will die tonight. These are fearful words, and we will be heard by all those who have wasted the opportunities that God has given them to live a godly life. All those uninterested in living a life pleasing to God, they will hear the fearful words, thou fool. How wonderful to hear different words from the Savior as we face Him and He says, well done, thou good and faithful servant. And I believe as I'm standing here that Jim Davis heard those words from our Savior just a few hours ago. Not only is life precious, not only is it brief, not only is it not to be wasted, but life is a gift from God. Like any gift, it's to be received with thanksgiving and used appropriately, this flies in the very face of the culture today that talks only of entitlements. A great multitude of people today insist that they are owed this or that. It's a cruel distortion. Life is not an award. One does not earn it. It is a gift. The Bible says of those whose hearts are tremendously and wonderfully and fervently and forever changed, you are not your own. You are bought with a price. And so a thoughtful person therefore asks, who is the owner? And what does the owner want? The answer to the first question is, God is the owner. He is the giver and the sustainer of life. And the answer to the second question is, God expects the redeemed that we present ourselves as a living sacrifice, which is really a spiritual gift of thanksgiving to the one who gave the life eternal. Jim believed this, and it all began at an early age through the prayers and the teaching and the biblical instructions of his godly mother. As even a seven-year-old, Jim, after hearing from his mother the ways of salvation, opened his heart to the Lord, and he never looked back. In his preteen years, he was inclined toward the ministry. And each Sunday, he would make notes of the pastor's sermon or what he gathered from it. And they would talk about that later on during the week. And from the pastor's sermons and his notes and the teaching of his godly mother, instruction grounded Jim in a walk with the Lord, and his Christian faith was added to, and grew over the years. The high school years revealed an amazing aptitude in electronics, and that became his great interest in college, grad school, and doctoral degree, all the while keeping his personal walk with the Lord vital part of his life. As much as he loved studies, as much as he gained in his studies, he never forsook his own personal study of the Word of God. Now, Jim faced in his life some devastating crisis experiences through which his trust in the Lord and his reliance upon the promises in God's Word carried him through those dark and difficult and deep days. His personal pledge to God and his understanding of God's promises gave him an overwhelming peace of God in the midst of those dark hours. I remember him telling me that story one time, how angry he was and how he turned it over to the Lord, all the situations facing him. And in the morning, the sweet peace of God flooded his soul, and he was refreshed in his heart. The driving force of his life was his love of his family and of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he believed that, and he tried to explain that, not only to friends at work, but others he came in contact with, and those that he worked with even here in the church. He believed that the promises and the provisions of God are only for those who are believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. Just as we're not allowed in someone's house unless we're invited in and welcomed in, so we will not enter God's house unless we respond positively to the invitation he gives. And in the gracious providence of God, this invitation is extended to all who are here today. whatever your situation may be, apart from the love of God in your heart. For today, Jesus has said, whosoever will may come and drink of the waters of life freely. And again, come unto me, all you who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That heavy laden refers to the matter of sin in the human heart, which is a heavy load to carry until the Savior lifts it by his redeeming love. God's invitation is most simply, confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, and you will be saved. And who, and any who came in here today with a heavy heart in unbelief may certainly leave this place, not in that condition, but with a heart changed by the grace of God, from unbelief to belief, from darkness into light. And any who come and say, Lord, be merciful, to me, a sinner, shall leave this place transformed by the grace of God that transforms him and directed and guided him all the days of his life. May there be those who today, like Jim, a 7-year-old child, receive Christ as Savior and walk in the joy of the Lord from this building. Lord, may it be so. Give ears to hear those who will hear. Amen. Now we're going to conclude the service by singing that great Martin Luther hymn, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God." And we'll stand together to sing it. nor death can ever separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. May each of us here today live righteously and finish well, even as did your child, Jim Davis. We pray this in the strong name of Jesus. For you, O Lord, alone are the rock of ages, the fountain of living water, the joy of man's desire, the giver of rest to the contrary.